Good morning.
Good morning.
I'll explain a little bit how I got into studying the sanctuary. When back in the 60s, I ended up in the Adventist hospital. I was told, whatever you do, don't have anything to do with Seventh-day Adventists. And I really tried, but it was difficult because the hospital, Seventh-day Adventist hospital, was a block away. And of course, all of their people, you know, Adventist people, would come in and bank there. And so I couldn't really stay away from them completely. But I ended up in the hospital, which was between the Adventist, I was about a block from the Seventh-day Adventist hospital, and I ended up there. And that wasn't by choice, but at that time I couldn't find a doctor that had hours on Sunday. So that's how I ended up there. Well, to make a long story short, I went ahead and did some studying, and eventually this couple came in to me and they said, I understand that you teach Sunday school. And I said, yes, I've been teaching Sunday school for years. And they said, I'd like to tell you a little bit about our Sabbath schools. And I was gullible. And so I thought, what I'll do, I will go to their church on Sabbath, get these ideas, and go back to the Methodist church, because I wasn't and shared what I had learned from the Adventist church. And eventually I accepted Christ and was baptized. But the minister that baptized me, he was so special. His name was Elder William Kaufman. He has a son by the same name that lives out in California now. But anyhow, he was a saintly man. And he said to me, Ann, you need to study the sanctuary, inside and out. Inside and out. And so I got started in studying the sanctuary. And I just, to me, it's my favorite topic. At first, when I heard about the 2300 days and 457 BC and 1798, I thought, I'll never retain this. But anyhow, the Lord blessed. And I moved to West Virginia, and we were meeting in Welch, which is about 13 miles from here. And my husband, which is a small group of us, he said, why don't you talk on the sanctuary? So for two or three people, I didn't have a problem. When I get to a group like this, that most of you know about the sanctuary, I know there are a few that don't, but I get a little bit nervous. And so I thought, well, this is a good place to practice, you know. And so lo and behold, these people were older than me. And they had been in the church like 40-some years back then. They never heard about the sanctuary. Mm. And I thought, how sad. Because to me, the sanctuary is the most beautiful love story in the world. It is beautiful. What's my purpose with sharing this with you today? My purpose is to stimulate your minds that you will study it more, because you'll never get through studying the sanctuary. The more I learn, the more I realize I don't know. And then on top of that, I was here, I think it was last year or year before last, and Brother David Sims here, he was talking about the sanctuary, and he brought in different aspects of it that I had never even considered. Wow, the light comes on. And once you study the sanctuary and you have some understanding of it, you need to read the conflict series all over again. Let's see how this works. Now, I like to give credit where credit is due. Sister Dorothy McCrillis and Ron Toll, they have been working with me on my study. And it's just been so beautiful having someone to study with. And Dot would call me up, oh, did you know this about the breastplate? Or, and I'll call her back, did you know that? You know, and so try to get someone, when you're learning and studying, try to get someone teamwork. So we do have this on display, plus some posters and things that you will find very, very interesting. So I'll get into my presentation now, but I really appreciate the hard work that Dorothy and Ron did. And of course, Terry, he was the one taxing them all over the place trying to find things to put into their presentation. Let's turn to Judges chapter 16. Excuse me. Judges chapter 16. And follow along with me, and we'll start Judges 16:16. Tamala, there you go, Judges 16:16. We were talking about what Brother Scusi was talking about last night, 1:1, you know, Genesis 1:1. And this is chapter 16 of Judges, verse 16, we'll start. And we're talking about Samson. I'm not going to go into all his background, but this is coming up to about the time he meets Delilah. And it came to pass when she, that's Delilah, pressed him daily with her words and urged him so that his soul was vexed unto death. But he told her all his heart and said unto her, there hath not come a razor upon my head, for I have been a Nazarite unto God from my mother's womb. If I be shaven, then my strength will go from me, and I shall become weak and be like other men. And when Delilah saw that he had told her all his heart, she sent and called for the lords of the Philistines, saying, come up this once, for he hath showed me all his heart. Then the lords of the Philistines came up unto her and brought money in their hand. Verse 19, and she made him sleep upon her knees. And she called for a man, and she caused him to shave off 7 locks of his head. And she began to afflict him, and his strength went from him. And she said, the Philistines be upon thee, Samson. And he awoke out of his sleep and said, I go out as at other times before and shake myself. And he wist not that the Lord was departed from him. But the Philistines took him and put out his eyes and brought him down to Gaza and bound him with fetters of brass, and he did grind in the prison house. He was treated like an oxen. Howbeit, the hair of his head began to grow again after he was shaven. Then the lords of the Philistines gathered them together to offer a great sacrifice unto Dagon, their God, and to rejoice, for they said, our God hath delivered Samson, our enemy, into our hand. And when the people saw him, they praised their God, Dagon, for they said, our God hath delivered into our hands our enemy, and the destroyer of our country, which slew many of us. And it came to pass when their hearts were merry, that they said, call for Samson, that he may make us sport. And they called for Samson out of the prison house, and he made them sport, and they set him between the pillars. Remember that word, pillars. And Samson said unto the lad that held him by the hand, suffer, in other words, allow me that I may feel the pillars whereupon the house standeth, that I may lean upon them. Now the house was full of men and women, And all the lords of the Philistines were there. And there were upon the roof about 3,000 men and women that beheld while Samson made sport. And Samson called unto the Lord and said, O Lord God, remember me, I pray thee, and strengthen me, I pray thee, only this once, O God, that I may be at once avenged of the Philistines for my two eyes. And Samson took hold of the two middle pillars upon which the house stood, and on which it was borne up, one of the one with his right hand, and with the other with his left hand. And Samson said, let me die with the Philistines. And he bowed himself with all his might, and the house fell upon the lords and upon all the people that were therein. So the dead which he slew at his death were more than they which he slew in his life. You see what happens. Sam's there and he gets a hold of these pillars. Push, pull, whatever. And what happened?
The building
comes tumbling down. Why did I bring this out? Simply because the church, I'm talking about the organized church primarily, the church is fooling around, playing around, whittling around the pillars of our belief. That is why, and Pastor Allen has said it many times, don't take my word for it. Go to the Word. And I praise God, because if I had not been counseled to study the sanctuary, I wouldn't have known about the one or two apartment sanctuary. Because we had what Desmond Ford, that was his thing, a one apartment sanctuary. No. And I'll go into more of that tomorrow. See, here is a... here is an illustration of Samson with it coming down, with the pillars coming down. And when the pillars come down, the structure comes down. You've got to have a good foundation. And I firmly believe that our foundation is Matthew 16, 16 through 18. Now, we'll talk a little bit about the encampment. There are many things that I see in the sanctuary. I see beauty. I see love. I see mercy. I see organization. Nothing in God's plan is haphazard. And so we have this encampment, and we have all these tents around it. And I want to show you another one. I don't know how well you can see that. But the sanctuary is right in the center of the encampment. And then you saw the cloud above it. And at the time the Lord wanted them to move on, the cloud would rise and it would move forward. They even had a special way. The Kohathites, these are Levites, and they each had a part in moving the encampment. There were 50 encampments approximately during a 40-year period. And if you want to look at this closer later, you can. And I have put down the various tribes as well as how many is in the tribe. And down here you'll see how many they were numbered, 20 years old and upward. The standards, and I really like what Ron had done with the standards. I'd like for you to take a good look at the sanctuary that he's put together in the fellowship room. And then also I indicate down in the corner who the mother was of each of the tribes. But you know, I find that God has a great desire. We all have desires of one sort or another. But you know what God's greatest desire is? He wants to dwell in us. And usually when I pray, it's not, I pray that God will be in our midst, but also in our hearts. We need him. He needs us. We need to vindicate his character. He's right. He's righteous. His judgments are sure. Well, we learn in John 14, chapter 14. I think this is one chapter, and I'm going to work on it now, too, that we should really memorize. There is so much meat in that particular chapter. John 14, 6 tells us, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. So how many ways are there?
One.
One. I've heard so many people say, well, you've got your way and I've got my way. But God's word says there's only one way, and that is through Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And now, what is that way?
Thy way,
O Lord, is in the sanctuary. Where is that found?
Psalm
77, verse 13. Okay. And then, this is okay, a sanctuary. What is he talking about? We go to Exodus 25, 8. Let's go there. I'm sure most of you know it, you quote it by heart, but I still like to. And let them make me a sanctuary that I may.
Well.
What was that?
Dwell.
That I may dwell among them. So he wants to be in our midst. Okay, we do have problems, don't we? Everybody has a problem of some sort. And, you know, in this book, there's an answer to all our problems. He says, come unto me. We need to approach our Lord Jesus. And he that have seen him has seen also the Father. All right, I'm going to. Okay. As you approach this court, you have, it's an enclosure about 75 feet by 150. And they had a white wall around it of linen, white. In the Jewish nation, colors, items had significance. And you know, we have the same thing in this country today. What does this country have as its emblem, so to speak?
Red, white, and blue.
Okay, but I was looking for
eagle.
The eagle, the bald eagle, right. And so there's significance. I know I've been out of the country and when I've come back, I look and I see Old Glory. And it's just something that just touches your heart. And this, in this case with the Jewish nation, that white represented something. Let's go to Revelation 19, verse 8. Revelation 19. Don't take my word for it. You get your Bibles out and turn to it. Verse 8. And to her was granted that she should be arrayed in fine linen, clean and white. For the fine linen is the righteousness of the saints. Where does the righteous get their, where do the saints get their righteousness? From the Lord Jesus alone. So there's other ones that go along with this, but because of time, I want to go ahead and go over a couple other ones. Red represents sacrifice and offering. Blue, redemption, obedience to God's word. And I think of, when I think of the blue too, I also think of the law. And as I've studied, I honestly believe that the law was engraved with the Ten Commandments in a blue stone. It would only seem fitting. Gold represents divinity. Job 22:35 in the margin. Then you have silver, obedience to the law. Now silver, remember, there was someone that was sold for 22 pieces of silver. Mm-hmm. Who was it?
Joseph.
Oh, yeah. Christ was sold for how many?
30
pieces of silver. Then you have pillars. For this one, let's go to Revelation 3. Revelation chapter 3. Verse 12. Him that overcometh will I make a pillar in the temple of my God, and he shall go no more out. And I will write upon him the name of my God. Wait a minute, I got the wrong verse. I said, well, let me finish reading this. The name of the city of my God, which is New Jerusalem, which cometh down out of heaven from my God, I will write upon him my new name. No, the one I'm looking for, help me out. It's to one of the churches, maybe Thyatira. Let me. No. Wait a minute. I'll get it in here in just a minute. Sorry.
Pillar of the church in Galatians?
No, it's to one of the churches.
You can make him a pillar in the temple of
God. Yeah. Right. And that is in. What is it?
Verse 12.
Well, that's what I thought. I wasn't reading it. That's what I had down. Chapter 2.
No, it's chapter 3.
Oh, that's what the problem is. Okay, thank you. Him that over.
That's what we read.
We just read that.
Oh, okay. I was thinking of another color instead. Yeah, he will make him a pillar in my temple. And I really get excited about this because in, I think, early writings, we are told that only the 144,000 follow the Lamb whithersoever he goeth. And they can follow him in the temple. Only the 144,000. So we really and truly need to strive to be among that group. And you know, you've heard the saying. I'm amazed at how many things and sayings that we have, like true blue. You've heard of that. She's true blue. How it goes back to some of the verses in scripture. And wood, let's go to Psalms 1:3. And he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that bring forth his fruit in season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. In God's word, wood, stubble, grass represents humanity. And in the construction of the furniture, in this particular case, the burnt offering altar, all that along with all of the other furniture in there was made from acacia wood. And the acacia wood, from what I understand, it does not get real big, tall, But it has lots of thorns on it, and you have to remove the thorns before you can work with it. And I'm thinking all the wood, the boards and all that went into the construction of the sanctuary. And here, it made it in 6 months. The construction of the sanctuary took about 6 months. And so you have the wood. And with the brazen altar, it was covered with brass. Now, something, so many pictures really bother me. But in this case, the altar has a compass around it. The priests would walk up, if they needed to, they would walk up the little ramp-like, and they would walk around it to adjust the offering that was being sent up. But it was covered with brass. And then you had the laver. And the laver, whenever it's mentioned, it is mentioned the laver and its foot. This being the foot down there. And they washed at it. And before they entered into their service for the day, they always washed their hands and their feet at the laver. Then you had all during the day. I kept thinking, well, that laver can be there for a good while with water. But then, of all the sacrifices and all, that they had common priests emptying the dirty water, filling it with the clean. This is the table of showbread. And this was made of wood, acacia wood again. And it was covered with gold, representing how Christ, all of this represents Christ, how Christ came to humanity. He had his divinity covered with humanity so that we could approach him. But we, being the wood, needs to allow Christ to work on our hearts, dwell within us, that we will be covered with the gold divinity. The altar incense, now again, this picture is not quite right because they only had two rings on this, it shows four. But daily, they would go ahead and offer incense in the morning and in the evening. And that also was made of acacia wood with covered with gold. The candlestick was one talent of gold. And that too was trimmed in the morning and in the evening at the same time when the altar of incense was, when the incense was offered on the altar of incense. Now this is the Ark of the Covenant, where God's law is, and I'll get into more of that tomorrow. But let's turn to Romans chapter 3. Romans 3. Verse 23. For some have sinned. What? Oh, I'm glad you're following. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. All have sinned. We live long enough, we're going to sin. Okay? But there is a solution. There is a solution. Let's go to chapter 6. Verse 23, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. You know, I love that little word, but. Don't you? And I think, you know, I'm glad you all didn't know me before I became a Seventh-day Adventist. But I wasn't into drugs and alcohol and stuff of that sort. But worldly. And when I first learned about Adventism, I was really convicted But I thought, you know, it's such a small matter. And that was my makeup and my jewelry. And so I wanted to be baptized, and I went to the minister that was going to be baptizing the people, and I said, I want to be baptized. I said, but I'm not joining your church. You understand? I will give my tithe and offerings, and I'll be on Sabbath, and I'll help wherever I can. I'm not joining your church. And this went on for a month or so. And one day he came to the house, and I could tell he meant business. And he says to me, why won't you join the church? And I said, it's such a small matter. And he says to me, if it's so small, why can't you give it up? I didn't have an answer. Didn't have an answer. And it was hard. I know some people have the Sabbath. I can understand, you know, the Sabbath situation. But just a little bit of makeup and just a little earrings, you know. And I got to thinking about it. So I decided to pack up all my jewelry and put it in a box and mail it to the Voice of Prophecy. I only kept my wedding band. And so when it was time for my baptism, the minister says to me, now, I'll baptize you, but you got to take that ring off. Then after you come out, you can put it back on. And I thought, what are you talking about? If it's so important for me to take it off to be baptized, it's not going to go back on. And so I had no clue where the wedding band is today. But, you know, there's small things in all of our lives that we need to get rid of. I still have items, things that I need to get out of my life. And you know what? I believe the same thing applies to probably most people here. Because we're here. We haven't been translated yet. So let's remember, it's the small things that can get us in deep trouble. Now, we start talking about sin, for all have sinned. Okay. What is sin? Okay. Thomas, you want to put this up? I want to talk about the sin offering. Now, I will share with you that in at the brazen altar that we saw earlier, in Leviticus chapter 1. Now, when I first read Leviticus and Numbers and Deuteronomy, I thought to myself, when will I get through this? But you know what? After I started studying the sanctuary and started connecting the dots, it's beautiful. It is absolutely beautiful. Leviticus chapter 1, they talk about the burnt offering. And with that one, I'll give you an illustration, was the offering of Abraham's son Isaac. That was a whole burnt offering. God doesn't want 99.99% of you, Georgie. He wants 100%, not only Georgie, but for each one here. In chapter 2, it says the meat offering, but it's not really meat. It's meal, like flour. Chapter 3 of Leviticus is a peace offering. Chapter 4, the sin offering, which I'll come back to. Chapter 5, which is very similar to the sin offering. And then there's the red heifer. And I love reading about that. It's just, they say it's quite beautiful to watch them as the Israelites would participate in the red heifer offering. But what is this sin about? Is sin all about? Well, let's go to 1 John 3:4. 1 John 3:4. Let's all read it together. Whosoever committeth sin transgresses also the law. For sin is the transgression of the law. It's very simple. You can't break a law if they don't have it. And what amazes me is I know Glenn was trying to study with this one family not too far away, and they kept saying, the law, it's been done away with. Glenn says, oh, that means I can get me another lady other than my wife, and I can go out and we can rob a bank. Oh, no, you don't do that. Why? Well, it's the Ten Commandments. Glenn says, there's no difference. You break one, you break them all, don't you? But they want to nail the Sabbath to the cross. Let's not let them do that. Okay. I'm skipping over some because this is more important to me about the various offerings. Here they had four types of sin offerings. And this is Leviticus 4. And after today, I'd like for you to go and just study them out because there's something very important in here. The first in Leviticus chapter 4, verses 2 and 3, was the offering of the bullock without blemish. There's one thing that all these offerings have in common, and that without blemish and without spot. So the priests examined these animals very closely before they were offered, because it had to be without blemish and without spot, pointing to the spotless Lamb of God, which taketh away the sins of the world. With the priest, the method was the priest lays his hands on the victim. Now, when they did that, I neglected to tell you that whenever they pitched the tent, it was always facing the east. There's a reason for that. When you face the east, which I think is over there, when you face the east, you've got your back to
the west.
Okay. All right. When they were facing the east, they were looking by faith into the most holy place where rested the law of God that they had broken. So they would place their hands on the victim and confess their sins. Then the priest kills the victim. Can you imagine killing an animal? It's serious. They would kill the victim. They would take the blood, sprinkle blood before the veil in the tabernacle of the congregation or the holy place. They would sprinkle it before the veil, and they would put some on the horns of the altar of incense. And the rest of the blood would be poured out at the brazen altar, which is out in the court. The priest cuts away all fat and burns fat on the brazen altar. Skin, flesh, head, legs, inwards, and dung are carried out of the camp until a clean place and burned. Okay, now suppose the whole congregation sins. Can you give me an example when the whole congregation sinned, or just about 99% of it sinned?
The golden calf,
the worshiping of the golden calf. So when the whole congregation sins, they bring a young bullock without blemish. And this is Leviticus 4, 13 and 14. The elders would lay their hands on the victim and confess the sins. The elders kill the victim. The priest sprinkles blood before the veil and puts some on the horns of the altar of incense. The rest of the blood is poured out at the bottom of the brazen altar. The priest cuts away all fat and burns the fat on the brazen altar. And the same thing transpires here that we had here. But it's the priest that cuts away the fat. Did you catch that? What does the priest do? He cuts away the fat. Okay, now we're going to go to a ruler, Leviticus 4, 22 and 23. He brings a male kid without blemish. Now, what do you think would be more value, a bullock or a male kid?
A bullock.
A bullock. Mm-hmm. There's a reason for that illustration. The ruler lays his hands on the victim and confesses sins. He kills the victim. The priest puts the blood on the horns of the brazen altar out in the tabernacle of the congregation. The priest eats some of the flesh in the holy place. Just the size of an olive was all they needed, transferring the sin from themselves to the victim. The rest of the blood is poured out at the bottom of the brazen altar. Priest cuts away all the fat, burns the fat on the brazen altar. The common people. So look around, I think most of us would fall in that category. I don't think all would, but I think most would fall in the category of the common people. A female kid or lamb without spot or blemish, the people lay their hands on the victim and confess their sins. The people kill the victim. Christ puts the blood on the horns of the brazen altar. The priest eats flesh in the holy place. And you can see Leviticus chapter 10, 16 through 18 for that. The rest of the blood is poured out at the bottom of the brazen altar. The priest cuts away all fat and burns fat on the brazen altar. All of the victims had to be spotless, blemish-free. The person that committed the sin, that's you and me, had to kill the victim. But who cuts away the fat?
The priest.
The priest. All we can do is confess our sins to the Lord Jesus. We can't get rid of sin. But allowing Christ within us, we can do all things, can't we? So we have our part to do. Some people say, oh, it's just faith only, you know. No. We have a work to do in this plan of salvation. Put off today your salvation. If you have not given your life to Christ. And I'm also talking to my son. We need to do it now. About 5 years ago, I had a grandson. It was a Friday afternoon. Alan, my son, and my grandson, they were working on a deck. And my grandson says to me, Granny, I'll be in church next week, not this week. We've got to do this and this. And I said, okay. He knew I was disappointed. By that same, that was about 2 o'clock in the afternoon, Friday afternoon. By 2 o'clock, Sabbath afternoon, he was dead. We can put off too long. When God's people are ready, he's going to come. Ready or not, he's coming. And I often look back. I know that it was in Jason's heart. He told me, he says, I want Aaliyah. That was his baby. He says, I want her. I want you for her teacher. And And Jason was doing a little work with his wife, you know, talking about diet. He didn't want pork. I know his heart was turned, leaning towards spiritual matters. If he will be in the kingdom, I don't know. I don't know. God knows. It's in God's hands, and God does not make a mistake.
Amen.
2 months after that, Glenn and I had a delightful morning together. We were taking care of some of the material paperwork from Jason's death. And we came back home, and he decided, instead of taking his usual afternoon nap, that he was going to go out and take care of some more business. He only got about 7/10 of a mile from here. He had the accident, and he died 16 days later. But my point is, we mustn't put off to tomorrow. We need to take action now.
Amen.
And if any of you have not made your commitment to Christ, I beg you, now is the time. We don't know if we're going to be around here 24 hours from now. I don't want to play on your emotions, but I want you to give this serious consideration. And if there are those listening, and besides my son, that have not made their decision, you're right there in your home. You can fall to your knees, accept Christ as your Savior. There's a scripture that I so love. Let's turn to 1 John. 1 John chapter 4. Oh, I'm sorry. 1 John chapter 1. Verse 9. And I said, this is one of my favorites. If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
Amen.
Something else I wanted to point out here is they burn the fat. What's the significance of that?
Sin.
What?
Sin. Destruction of sin.
I know I've gone in apartment buildings after I became an Adventist and hadn't flesh for many years, and you smell it burnt, you smell people cooking it, it almost makes me sick. Why is that a sweet savor unto the Lord? It's an end to sin. And eventually, all the fat's going to be destroyed. All sin is going to be destroyed. Again, I would like for you to go into the fellowship room when you have time. Look at the work that Dorothy and Ron have been into. And tomorrow we're going to talk about the atonement. Because remember, when we confess our sins, they have been covered. Just because our sins are covered doesn't say that's the end. They're covered. When something is covered, what can you do? It can be revealed again. So, that concludes my presentation for you.